Next on Enviro Close-Up, Gordon Edwards, president of the Canadian Coalition for Nuclear Responsibility. Welcome to Enviro Close-Up. I'm Carl Grossman with Dr. Gordon Edwards. He's the president of the Canadian Coalition for Nuclear Responsibility and an expert on nuclear technology. Welcome, Dr. Edwards.
Thank you, Carl. I'm glad to be here.
What I'd like to talk to you about, Dr. Edwards, is this push by the nuclear industry worldwide for, well, kind of, they claim, new and improved nuclear power plants, so-called advanced nuclear reactors. You've been particularly critical, especially, in fact, a leader in the world in terms of criticizing this new push, particularly in terms of small modular reactors, so-called SMRs. What do you think about this push? What do you think about these would be new and improved nuclear power plants?
Well, I think it's an opportunity for the nuclear industry to try and rescue itself from a very dramatic decline. For the last 25 years, people may be surprised to know that there has been basically no growth in the world nuclear industry. There's only four more reactors in 2021 compared with 1997. So it's been flatlining for 25 years. And you may remember, Carl, back in around the year 2000, 2001, there was talk about a nuclear renaissance. At that time, they were not talking about small reactors. They were talking about big ones. They were going to build big reactors, thousands of them all over the world. And in fact, that turned out to be a fiasco. They only ordered a handful of reactors, and each one of them cost at least two or three times as much money as they said it would cost, and took at least three or four times longer than they said it would take to build them. So we've been around the block once before on this question of revitalizing the nuclear industry. I believe that what's happening now is that the nuclear industry, which has been failing, is now looking at the opportunity to get a lot of money, because they know that there's going to be trillions of dollars on the table for solutions to climate change. And they figure, hey, there's a bundle of money that we should grab as much as we can. So what they're doing is they're putting forward a lot of speculative ideas, things that were tried 50, 60 years ago and were never successfully commercialized. And now they're trying to finally get around to commercializing them and get the money from the government, because the private capital is not forthcoming unless they can get the government to lay out some money first. The government money encourages private capital. And so it's kind of like a fishing expedition. If we can talk the governments into giving us some money, then maybe we can get private capital in there too. Their biggest problem is they don't have customers. If they looked at the market is non-existent. Nobody is beating down the door to buy these new reactors. On the contrary, it's like the Fuller Brush Man. He's going from door to door trying to find customers, except that nobody's buying right now. So that's the problem with the small modular reactors. They're just not able to compete. And of course, the problem is the competition is so much better. The renewable energy is a lot cheaper and is growing much, much faster. And what's more, it doesn't require a PhD to build a solar installation or to build a windmill. You don't need to have thousands of highly trained engineers and scientists to build these alternative energy sources. And they can be put up quickly within one or two building seasons.
Now, the claim of the nuclear industry is that these new advanced nuclear power plants, nuclear reactors are safer than the existing generation. And you say that's not true. Could you elaborate?
Well, there's a fundamental problem with nuclear power, and it doesn't matter whether it's small, whether it's big, it doesn't matter what the design is, it doesn't matter what the coolant is, or even what the fuel is. It's all based upon splitting atoms. And when you split atoms, they don't disappear. You get hundreds of broken pieces of atoms. And these broken pieces of atoms are millions of times more radioactive than the fuel that you started with. Now, any accident, really what a nuclear accident is simply recognizing the fact that a nuclear reactor, no matter what its size, is not just a machine for generating electricity or heat, but it's also a warehouse of radioactive poisons. And anything that blows those poisons out into the environment constitutes a disastrous accident. So that can happen if you're small, that can happen if you're big. That can happen no matter what the design is. So when they say that they may be safer, well, how safe is safe enough? If you had a warehouse full of toxic poisons, any kind of earthquake or industrial accident, even careless management, or let's take Zaporizhia, for example, in Ukraine, enemy forces dropping bombs on any reactor of any size is going to disperse those radioactive poisons throughout the environment. So that's a fundamental fact about nuclear power, and you can't get around it.
The pitch for smaller reactors, the industry kind of claims that they'll be easier to get out there and to get working. And what about that?
Well, we've had small reactors, and they haven't worked so well. As a matter of fact, all of the original reactors were small. We had a small reactor here in Canada. It was called the NRX reactor. It had the first major nuclear accident in the world, a meltdown in 1952 with hydrogen gas explosions and so on. These small reactors are just as prone to failure as larger reactors, and they cost more money. The reason they went to larger reactors is economy of scale. If you want to build a large reactor that produces twice or three times as much electricity, you don't need two or three times as much material. You don't need two or three times as many safety systems. And consequently, you can produce more electricity at less cost. But what we've seen is that because of the complexity and difficulties of managing these radioactive materials, the cost of nuclear power keeps going up and up and up. And these small reactors are going to be more expensive, not less expensive, than existing reactors. Meanwhile, the alternatives, the solar and wind power, for example, the price of these is plummeting. It's been going down steadily from the first time they came on the scene. So the nuclear costs keep going up. The renewable costs keep going down. And they've already crossed over. The renewables are now about four times cheaper than nuclear. And so the competition is fierce. As a matter of fact, the International Energy Agency has said 91% of new energy growth is expected to be renewables in the coming year. And they've had to adjust their projections of renewable contributions to energy supply upwards time and time again, because the reality keeps exceeding their projections. So they make a projection, and then the actual construction of these plants is larger than they anticipated. So they have to keep adjusting their projections upwards. Just recently, they announced that they would have to once again increase the projected use of renewables by 25% because it's just growing too fast. Nuclear, on the other hand, is going nowhere. What's happened is that, the share of nuclear electricity globally has dropped from 17% in 1997 to less than 10% today. So it's been rapidly declining. That's because the new reactors are not being built. And if we start investing now in new reactors, these small modular reactors, it's going to take at least 10 years before you see anything coming out of it. Therefore, all that time, the greenhouse gas emissions are getting worse, and you're getting absolutely no benefit while you're building these reactors. Maybe 10 years later, if you're lucky, you might have a plant that starts producing electricity. It's going to take a few years to pay itself off, and then you're going to have to put aside a lot of the capital that you earn by producing electricity a lot of that money is going to have to be put aside to deal with radioactive waste and the robotic dismantling of these plants, because they become radioactive, the structures themselves, at the end of their lifetime. With renewables, you can build renewables in one or two growing, let's say, seasons, and then you get a rapid payback. You get a rapid payback, and you don't have to put any of it aside for waste disposal or for decommissioning, maybe a small amount. That money is already, in just a few years, ready to reinvest in more, and that's why it keeps multiplying so much faster. It's what we call exponential growth. It's like a short interest rate. You borrow money at a lower interest rate, and it pays itself off in a quarter of the time.
And then meanwhile, if financial resources are poured into these so-called advanced nuclear reactors, that money is not going to be used for renewable, safe, clean, green energy technologies, solar and wind and so forth.
Yeah, that's correct. And one of the so the nuclear industry keeps changing its story, and they now say that, well, nuclear is the perfect complement to renewables because it can provide the sort of hard 24/7 backup that renewables need, because the sun is not always shining and the wind is not always blowing. And so nuclear can fill in the gap there. But as a matter of fact, experience has shown the opposite, that countries, in fact, that have invested heavily in nuclear have done very poorly at greenhouse gas reduction and have also done very poorly in renewables. Meanwhile, the countries that have invested in renewables rather than nuclear have done far better at greenhouse gas reduction, and the two seem to be relatively incompatible. The money that goes to nuclear is taken away from the renewable investments. So we're starving Peter to feed Paul, as it were. And unfortunately, Paul is not only a lot hungrier, but he's also a lot less productive. He just sits on his butt and doesn't do as much as quickly as the nimble renewables do. Now, something even more important, however, than renewables is energy efficiency. Going way back to even 1977 in the Carter administration, President Carter, when he came to power, he did two interesting things in the context of this discussion. Number one, he banned plutonium reprocessing. That means taking the nuclear fuel and extracting one of the many elements that are created as a byproduct in the reactor, and that's called plutonium. Now, the thing about plutonium is that it can be used straight away for nuclear weapons. Not all uranium can be used for weapons. It has to be highly enriched first. But with plutonium, all plutonium can be used immediately in weapons, in nuclear weapons. So there's a problem of proliferation of nuclear weapons technology around the world. If you want to have reactors that are producing plutonium and even using plutonium as a fuel, as we have here in Canada, then you're really spreading the wherewithal for countries all over the world to make their own atomic bombs and nuclear weapons. And that's a serious consideration. On the basis of that, President Carter banned plutonium reprocessing in the United States of America. At the same time, he created an institute called the Solar Energy Research Institute. And he asked the institute to study how much of American energy needs could be met with solar energy. And the story that came back was, it was called A New Prosperity. It was the study of the SERI report. And they said, you know what? It's easy for solar energy to make a major impact in meeting energy needs, but the key is, first of all, to be energy efficient. So the first investment should always be energy efficiency, because the cheapest bit of energy you'll ever have is the energy you didn't waste. And in fact, Amory Levins calls it negawatts instead of megawatts. And I'll just give you an example. Here in Quebec, we use a lot of electrical heating. It's kind of almost a law in Quebec that new residences have to have electrical heating. Well, if you converted the existing electrical heating in the province of Quebec to heat pumps instead of direct resistance heating, you would save about 2.5 times the electricity. And the amount of electricity you save, if you can calculate it simply by arithmetic, the amount of electricity you save would be enough without building any new generating facilities to run the entire transportation sector of Quebec. If you had electrical vehicles, if all the vehicles were electrical, you could run that entire transportation sector with the energy savings. Now, that's the smart way to go. So, you know, the thing to do is to think about not wasting energy. In fact, the first law of thermodynamics scientifically is that energy is neither created nor destroyed. It is simply converted from one form into the other. If we took that to heart, we'd realize that the less energy we use to do a job, the more successful we are. It's not using more energy that makes us more successful. It's using less energy that makes us more successful. And that's why this study that Carter commissioned was called A New Prosperity. It's saying this is the way that America can really be prosperous.
Now, speaking of research, Stanford University here in the United States has done important research on the waste produced, the nuclear waste produced by these small modular reactors being many times more than the big conventional reactors.
Yeah, that's a paradoxical thing, but it's understandable because the small reactors mean that all the components of the construction materials are much closer to the core of the reactor, where the actual fission of atoms takes place. And it's those stray neutrons that come radiating out from the core that when they strike non-radioactive materials, they magically transform them into radioactive materials. So you get an enormous amount of radioactive material buildup in the steel, in the concrete, even in the water. Even the water becomes radioactive from the formation of tritium, which is a radioactive form of hydrogen. Carbon becomes radioactive carbon, carbon-14. Chlorine becomes chlorine, an isotope of chlorine, which is radioactive, which has a 300 million year half-life. So what we're doing here is that we look at these reactors as if they produce electricity. But if you were from outer space and looking at Earth as a kind of an ant colony, you might see that nuclear reactors, actually what they're producing is radioactive waste that lasts for millions of years and plutonium that lasts for hundreds of thousands of years. And the electricity is just a blip on the radar screen. You get a little blip of electricity for maybe 20 or 30, or maybe if you're lucky, 40 years. And then you get thousands and thousands, even millions of years of radioactive waste and plutonium, which are headaches for future generations. In fact, you could say we're planting the seeds of our own destruction in that sense, because any regime thousands of years from now can go to a site where there was nuclear waste stored. They can dig up that waste and extract the plutonium and use it in nuclear weapons. So we are actually creating repositories of weapons material that were not there in nature.
Can you tell us about the Canadian Coalition for Nuclear Responsibility?
Yes, the Canadian Coalition for Nuclear Responsibility was founded way back in 1970. And the reason for it was because we found that here in Canada, people were simply not being told the truth about nuclear energy. For instance, we were told, and I believed at that time what I've been told, which is that nuclear energy is a clean technology, that it doesn't produce any pollution. I thought, wow, that's great. Also, I was told that it had nothing to do with nuclear weapons. I thought, that's good. And I was told that it was cheap. So it sounded to me like this is a great deal. And I was at that time quite pro-nuclear, because who could be against it if that was all true? The fact of the matter is none of those things is true. It's not clean. It produces the most dangerous industrial waste of any industry ever in the history of humankind. These wastes are so toxic that it's been calculated that the waste from all the American nuclear reactors, even after 1 million years, would be enough to pollute the entire Great Lakes system, meaning that if it was dissolved into the water of the Great Lakes, all of that water would be rendered undrinkable because of the... So this is a very highly... And that's after 1 million years of storage. After a few years of storage, after the first 10 years of storage, they say there wouldn't be enough fresh water on Earth to dilute this to the maximum permissible level of contamination. So it's hard to imagine just how toxic this stuff is. Then you have the cheapness. Well, we've seen how the cost of nuclear has gone through the roof. And in fact, even disposing of the waste here in Canada is going to cost in excess of $26 billion. I don't know how many billions you've already spent in the United States trying to find a home for these wastes, but you know, there's been eight different attempts in the United States to locate a waste repository that would be safe enough for these wastes. And all eight methods have so far tried, they have all failed. The most recent one being the Yucca Mountain site. We're not striking, we're not doing very well in terms of a batting average here. And finally, we have the connection with war. We discovered to our dismay in Canada that in 1974, India exploded its first atomic bomb and set off the rivalry between India and Pakistan, where they both now are armed to the teeth with nuclear weapons. And we Canadians gave a nuclear reactor to India as a gift. And they used that nuclear reactor, plutonium produced in it, for their first atomic bomb. So all of these things are actually, if I may be blunt, lies. And the Canadian Coalition for Nuclear Responsibility was formed to give people true information about it, critical information. It's true. We figure that the industry does a pretty darn good job of promoting itself. We explain things. We explain how nuclear power works and how it's supposed to work. But we also point out that these problems are not avoidable. There's no way technologically you can avoid these problems, because every nuclear reactor, as it operates regularly, just normal operation, is constantly producing the high-level radioactive waste and constantly producing plutonium as a byproduct. In first, the first reactors built, both in the United States, in Canada, in Britain, in Russia, in France, the first reactors ever built were all built to produce plutonium for bombs.
Well, what are these people who are in the nuclear establishment? And it's an establishment which, it's in the United States, it's in Canada, it's all over the world. What are they thinking? Don't they understand all this?
Well, you know, I think the Tolkien wrote that wonderful trilogy, you know, The Lord of the Rings, and he talked about the ring of power, that the only people who could be trusted with the ring of power were people who do not aspire to power. Because anybody who aspires to power, when they slip this ring onto their finger in order to acquire power, they find that they are possessed by it. And in fact, it's the ring that rules them rather than them ruling the ring. And I think nuclear power is a bit like that. First of all, it's important to realize that the force that holds the nucleus of the atom together is the strongest force in the entire universe. And if you are a scientist and somebody who is impressed by just nature itself, you say, well, it's pretty darn hard to turn your back on the strongest force in the universe. And so they're attracted to this force, almost a fatal attraction. The deeper you get into it, the more difficult it is to extract yourself from the attraction. The attraction becomes hypnotic. And so I see it as an addiction. And as a matter of fact, the International Physicians for the Prevention of Nuclear War won the Nobel Prize in 1985. And one of the things they said is that nuclear weapons are an addiction too, and that we're addicted to these things, and it's not easy to break ourselves of that addiction. We need everybody's help to sort of snap us out of it. We need the help of millions of ordinary people to see the common sense of making a sustainable planet that is not putting itself on the road to perdition, on the road to annihilation. And the danger is that in the pursuit of power, electrical power and political power and technological power, we may in fact imperil the entire planet. The beautiful thing about renewables and energy efficiency is that they lead us in a different direction. And even if they were not able to do the whole job of satisfying all of our energy needs, they would certainly make a big impact. They would give us immediate relief from the carbon emissions that we're now suffering from. If you have an emergency, if your house is on fire, the first thing you want to do is put out the fire, not sit around trying to design a better house. And similarly, I think that when we see this climate emergency as an emergency, we realize that we got to do the cheapest and fastest things first, and not spend our resources on something that may not even work. Because a lot of these reactors that are now being put forward, the small modular reactors, they're not tested. It's not a sure thing they're going to work at all. We've had in Canada several small reactors that have never worked. And so with wind and solar and these other things, you know they work. They're proven. There's no question about it. So why would you invest in something that's more expensive, slower, and speculative compared with something that is quick, fast, cheap, and sure?
And also to be noted, some of these new nuclear power plants, new reactors, like the sodium cool, I mean, that's an explosive proposition to use sodium.
Well, indeed. And in fact, they have had, of course, they point to the success of one reactor, the EBR-2, Experimental Breeder Reactor 2, which did operate for 30 years and did not explode. So they say, well, there's some hope there. That used liquid sodium as a coolant. But every time they tried to scale it up to commercial skies, it failed. The Fermi 1 reactor in the United States had a partial meltdown and never was successful. In France, which is one of the Saudi Arabias of nuclear power, you might say, they had to give up on the Super Phoenix, which was a fast breeder reactor using liquid sodium. Britain tried it and they failed. They had to back out of it. Germany built a fast reactor built cooled with liquid sodium. And they thought it was such a bad deal that they didn't even try and start it up. They've turned it into an amusement park. And so they've never successfully commercialized these ideas. You rightly point out that liquid sodium, just chemically speaking, anybody who's been in a chemistry lab knows the liquid sodium reacts violently on contact with air or water. And boy, oh boy, all it takes is a small leak. So they're plagued, these reactors, these liquid sodium reactors, are plagued with fires that are very destructive and very damaging. And they're radioactive fires as well, because the sodium itself becomes quite radioactive. But there's an even bigger problem there, and that is that these reactors, why do they use liquid sodium? Well, the reason they use liquid sodium is because it's more or less transparent to neutrons. It means the neutrons can pass through it like light through a window. And what that means is that you can produce a lot more plutonium. So the whole idea of liquid sodium reactors is to maximize the production of plutonium. And as if we didn't have enough troubles in the world today, we want to make our troubles bigger. So we want to grow the stockpile of plutonium, which is already a major headache in global politics. Because once the plutonium is separated out, any criminal organization that gets its hand on it can use that to make powerful nuclear weapons or even non-nuclear weapons, what are called radiological dispersal devices, dirty bombs, so-called. But you can even make powerful nuclear weapons from plutonium, and that could easily fall into the hands. It will, in fact, inevitably fall into the hands of criminals and terrorists if it becomes commercially traded. So once again, we're on the eve of destruction when we talk about liquid sodium reactors, where we're really trying to make plutonium the basis of the world's economy. It's called the plutonium economy, and there's been a lot written about it for many, many years. And it's certainly something that, a lot of people don't think that it's compatible with a longevity for human civilization.
Thank you so much, Dr. Gordon Edwards. You are brilliant, absolutely brilliant.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
This has been Enviro Close Up. I'm Carl Grossman. Thank you for watching.